Good evening and welcome. Before we begin, we request that you all turn off or silence your cell phones. We are going to begin our program tonight with Tehillim. Following Tehillim, the HAL 5th grade choir, under the direction of Sandy Shmueli, will lead us in the Star Spangled Banner and HaTikvah. We will ask then that you quietly find your seats following HaTikvah, at which point the choir will perform. We would like to remind the parents of the choir students that the children will be supervised until the conclusion of the program, and we would greatly appreciate if you could remain seated the entire time. Immediately after the choir concludes, a video will be shown. The video consists of excerpts from the Names Not Numbers program experienced by Hafter Middle School and Lawrence Middle School students last year. The Names Not Numbers program, founded by Tova Fish Rosenberg, is an inspiring and creative curriculum which transforms traditional history lessons into an interactive program involving individuals who live through the history being taught. We thank both Names Not Numbers and the Hafter Middle School administration for sharing these materials with us. Please rise for Tehillim.
Shira Mala Rimama Kim, Kartifa Adonai, Adonai Shema Bekoli, Tienas Lev Gashubo, Bekota Adonai, Ima Benot Ishmael Adonai, Mi Amo, Kim Cho, Aslikho, Laman, Tivare, Kivit Yadonai, Kipta Namshi, Elin Varo, Ochalti, Nafshi, Adonai, Mishomim, Laboker, Shomrim, Laboker, Yachel Israel, El Adonai, Kim Adonai, Chesed, Reba Mofedu, Behu, Yifte Israel, Mikol, Labonoto,
Thank you. To make it. get an opportunity to interview a Holocaust survivor and get to know their story.
You can engage in history by reading books, but it's even more powerful if you can sit down with someone who actually lived through it. Someone who can look you in the eyes and, you know, tell you about their story.
And they were identified as numbers and not people.
My name is Renee Slotkin.
My name is Sally Frischberg.
Names on Numbers is a program that works to create a documentary around interviewing, conducting oral histories with survivors of the Holocaust, the Shoah.
It's important to interview survivors so we remember their stories.
The students who were to choose to do the project will start that training. You'll be having a journalist come to teach you how to interview, and you'll learn how to film a documentary.
You have a survivor that comes from Germany that was Kristallnacht, 1938. They left Germany in 1939 or 1940, came to the United States. For them, the war's over. So you're going to be asking more questions about before the war, because they'll tell you about life in Germany.
I had a lot of family that died in the Holocaust, and my great-grandparents survived. My great uncle survived, so it's important to me. And I grew up learning about the Holocaust since I was a toddler.
We will be interviewing Eva Hoffman.
Today we are interviewing Regina Grossman.
My name is Mordechai Miller. I was born in January 11, 1931. I was growing up in Jablonka, Poland. My oldest Yehuda, he's a year younger than me.
My name is Regina. I was born in Czechoslovakia. 1926, we lived in which city? Chust.
My name is Renee Slatkin. I was born in Teplice Shanov, which is a small town in Czechoslovakia, slightly north of Prague. My father was taken to Auschwitz when I was only 3 years old, and he was shot, he was killed.
Hitler didn't declare war. On September 1st, 1939, he struck without warning.
The war started on September 1st. Within a couple of weeks, they were taking over everything.
Besides for school, did you feel any anti-Semitism, like on the streets?
There were 6, 7 year olds. I cannot understand. And they used to say, Jews go to Palestine.
The city was in deep mourning because almost every family had already evicted.
In 1940, we were in school and they took us out from school. They were hanging 3 young men because they were stealing potatoes. We had to stay and look. And I turned, I couldn't look.
A German officer walked into our house and he said to my mother, did one pillow, one dress, and one blanket, and you're out because you have to go to a ghetto.
My mother and my twin sister, we were put together first into Theresienstadt. Theresienstadt was a model camp that the Germans set up to show the public, the world, that all these horrible rumors that were going around were not true. They showed music and soccer games with happy this. I remember seeing all those things, but I do also remember seeing wagons running through the streets with dead bodies.
Slowly, they were separating families from their children. They were shooting down people on the steps on the way home.
There wasn't much to do.
Look for food, take care of my brother's children. And they also were taking boys away in the beginning, a lot of young men, to work. We never saw them again.
Used to risk your life to go get food. My mother used to sneak out from the ghetto and barter for clothing. Used clothing for food, for potatoes, whatever she could.
Because going to Auschwitz, instead of going to Auschwitz, we went to Bischendorf. The people were so scared when they took us there. A lot of people took lead poison, and they all died. They were standing straight like, they were all naked. That was the first shower we had after so many weeks, and we didn't know that it could have been gas.
But after was, they came to Auschwitz. They shaved our hair, take everything off. We didn't have nothing. The bed was the size of, let's say, a double bed. We had to lay 14 people on one side of, and 14 people on the other side.
Yeah. How did I get the number? It was put on me as soon as we got into the camp. It was a pen, we sat down, and there was a lady across, and she would tattoo the number in it. And I can show it to you.
I feel it's important to spread their stories and hear them firsthand.
Learned like a lot that I didn't know, and I was really happy that I met Holocaust survivors.
If we don't hear their stories, no one's ever gonna know like what happened.
Learn from it. Can you learn from it? Please learn from it. That's my message.
You have to learn from somebody else's mistakes. Don't try to forget your own mistakes.
It surprised me how relaxed he was talking about the story, and it almost seemed like it relieved him.
My message is to not take anything for granted, to value my family and all the time that I'm free.
Don't worry about the hat to set the lipstick and the diamonds and all these things. Worry about their lives.
After all she's gone through, she's able to recover and start her life again.
I take life to the way it comes. I'm happy. I love life. Thank God I have two beautiful granddaughters and my darling son.
It's a quote from Robert Alden. There is not enough darkness in all the world to put out the light of even one small candle.
Thank you. Thank you for listening to me.
Have a great future. A successful future, and a healthy and a peaceful one.
You should never forget.
And a special thank you to our entire committee for all their advice, input, and commitment. With particular thanks to Tova Keller, Sharon Shapiro, Neera Kimmel, Shannon Fogel, and Tara Mastor, who went above and beyond the call of duty. We also want to express our gratitude to the community rabbis who are here tonight and who have provided us with support and advice for this program. And we want to acknowledge Councilman Bruce Blakeman and thank him for his support of our community. At our Pesach Seder last week, my daughter shared the following insight that I found very thought-provoking. As human beings, we tend to think about what we will leave behind. What is the significance of our lives? Will we be remembered? Perhaps we should first ask ourselves, what do we remember about those that came before us? Can we list the names of our great-great-grandparents? Can we describe any of their qualities or personality traits? Perhaps not. Human memory is swept away by the present and tends to give little attention to the past. The Seder gives us the opportunity to pass along the memories and experiences of those that came before us. I may not have ever met my great-grandfather, but I know what he was doing many years ago on the first night of Pesach. Through the Haggadah, we connect to our past and to our future in an endless time tunnel. By retelling our story, we are planting ourselves into the history of our people. We are living in the present, but we are representing the past and inspiring the future. I heard Rabbi Lerfield from the Young Israel of Staten Island tell a story about a Jewish chaplain in the American Army who brought a few pairs of tefillin into a concentration camp that was being liberated. He approached two teenage boys and offered them a pair. They eagerly took the tefillin, but stood there quietly, simply holding them. After several minutes, the lieutenant approached the boys and asked why they weren't putting on the tefillin. The boys responded, "We would like to, but we don't know how. We had our bar mitzvahs in the camp. Can you pretend to be our father or our Zaidi and teach us how to put them on?" We say Hallel, which quotes Tehillim, "Lo amud ki ehyeh." We know there are no superfluous words in Tanakh. If David HaMelech wrote, Lo Amud, I will not die, it's understood, Echya, I will live. Why is there a need to write, Lo Amud, Ki Echya, I will not die, for I will live? David HaMelech was expressing the difference between not dying physically and actually living. Tonight, we are remembering the Kedoshim that were murdered, and we are honoring those that survived. The survivors of the atrocities of the Shoah went on to become an incredible generation. After losing so much, in some cases, after losing everything and everyone that mattered to them, after losing their faith in mankind, the survivors didn't simply not die, they lived. Like those liberated teenagers who asked someone to help them connect to their past and their traditions, the survivors built up their physical strength and their emotional and spiritual strength, and somehow were able to restart lives, build families, and renew traditions. So what does Yom HaShoah mean? Yom HaShoah designates a date on our calendar where we come together to remember. With each passing year, we lose more and more survivors. We lose our national heroes. We lose our eyewitnesses. Our responsibility to transmit these memories increases in its relevance and significance. We cannot fail in this task. We may not be able to bring back the dead to life, but we can bring the memory back to life, and we can ensure that they are not forgotten. We can undertake in our lives to do what they were so cruelly prevented from doing in theirs. Last year, my daughter participated in the Names Not Numbers program. The curriculum culminated with an event during which a video demonstrating the students' experiences, much like the video you just saw, was played. My eyes darted from the screen to my daughter and from my daughter to my father. Memories of my grandparents flooded through my mind and my heart. In that moment, I was not simply living in the present. I was experiencing the past, the present, and the future all at once. I felt as though I myself was marching through the snow with ill-fitted shoes and a rifle pressed to my back. I was homesick for a modest home in a small Polish village that I will never see. I longed for my grandparents so I could assure them, we did not forget, we remember, and so do our children. We read in the Haggadah, V'hi sha'am galavotinu v'lanu, shelo echad v'lvad, amad alinu l'chalotinu, ela shabachol dor vador, omdim alinu l'chalotinu, v'hakadosh baruch hu matzilenu mi'adam. In every single generation, someone will rise up against us and try to destroy us. They have, they do, and they will. Just weeks ago, an 85-year-old Holocaust survivor in Paris was stabbed to death. The attacks against us may never end, but no matter what the world throws our way, we will not disappear. It's not just Lo Amud that we won't die, but Lo Amud Ki Echya. We won't die because we will live. We will live and we will thrive. We come together tonight to remember, and tonight we may cry, but we can also proclaim so proudly that we as a people have not died. Those who were murdered are remembered. We have survived, and we will live. I would now like to call upon our Fania Gottesfeld-Heller keynote speaker. Mr. Israel Stark was born in 1929 in the Carpatho-Ruthenia region of Eastern Europe, then a part of the Czechoslovakian Republic. In March 1944, when Mr. Stark was 14 years old, his entire family was deported to Auschwitz-Birkenau. Over the next year, Mr. Stark was interned in three more concentration camps. He was liberated on May 6, 1945, and ultimately arrived in Chicago in 1948 after being sponsored by Eleanor Roosevelt together with other war orphans. Mr. Stark became a successful businessman and built a beautiful family with his wife. He and his wife Ethel are parents to seven children and are blessed with many children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Mr. Stark is the author of the book, A Boy Named 68818, and is one of the featured survivors at the USC Shoah Foundation New Dimensions in Testimony Projects. Mr. Stark.
You have just witnessed a group of kinderlich our future generations of boys and girls, future mothers and fathers. And I think that just this in itself, to witnessing this in itself, could be Dayenu, could be the whole program for the Shoah. And this is the answer to these Nazi murderers that we are Am Yisrael Chai. I would also like to ask your forgiveness and I would like to apologize for sitting down. Usually when I have been giving my experiences during those terrible days and war years, I have been standing up, but I think I'm going to take the chair and sit down, and thank you very much for allowing me to do that. Can you hear me? Bershus Morei de Asre, Rabbi Chaim Shliter. B'chol ha'oski b'tzorchei tzibur, Moirei v'raboisai, ladies and gentlemen of all ages, my heartfelt thanks for taking out your valuable time to hear my message on this day of Yom HaShoah. I would also like to take a moment and welcome to our Mrs. Lazan. Mrs. Lazan is somebody that has been giving over the message of the Churban Europe, or of the tragedy of the Churban in Europe, or the Shoah as we call it, for almost weekly for Jewish and non-Jewish groups. And I would say not only in the United States, but also in Europe and many other places. I'm very honored that Mrs. Marilyn Lazan was able to join us. Would you please stand up for a moment? I'm greatly honored your presence. The memory and message of the Pesach Seder is still with us. The entire Seder is built on the directive Min HaTorah of Zechira. You have to remember it. Stated as Vayigadatol Bincha, and you should tell the story of Yetziat Mitzrayim to your children in order to always remember it. And similarly, the same is true with the mitzvah of Zechoyer Ma'asa L'cho Amolek. Remember what Amolek did to you, even though we are specifically instructed to read Parsha Zohar and remember this at Purim time. It actually, this too is a directive for every day of the year. It is according to Chazal and Mitzvah Sasei Midoraita to remember Ma'asa L'cho Amolek, not only on Parsha Zohar, but every day. These events of Yetziat Mitzrayim and Haman's plan to eradicate all the Jews are events of long ago. And yet we are instructed to always remember them. So surely, events of similar oppressions and hardships which happened only 75 years ago, that is the tragedy of Churban Europe, must also be remembered and recalled to future generations. We have reached a time of Poiseich v'Holeich, when every day there are fewer and fewer survivors from the Shoah that can stand up in front of you or sit in front of you and proclaim, this is my story. This is what I was witness to, because each survivor experienced his or her own personal Mesiras Nefesh. Of the Nisim B'nei Flos, our own Yetziat Yisrael. Rabbi Meir Lau, the former chief rabbi of Israel, on a visit to Chicago many years ago, said, "Let's not talk anymore how our mothers, fathers, brothers, and sisters died during the terrible Khurban, but let's talk how they lived, not how they lived while they were in the city of Lodz or Warsaw or Munkacs or Chust, but how did they live during the worst of the Shoah in the Orient." And this is, my friend, what I wish to relate to you, how they lived during those days. I want to give you a little bit information about my personal background. I was born in a town called Podhorje, bordering the city of Munkacs, approximately between 2 and 2.5 kilometers from Munkacs. My father and his family were all Belz of Hasidim, and I am a Ben Yochid, or one boy of a family of four. I had three sisters, and I was the only son, or the only boy of his family. From the age of 7 years and older, I walked every day 3 kilometers approximately to Cheder in Munkacs, to the Donko Street. And in the bitter winter nights, I slept over by my grandparents in Munkacs. And then many times, if I was lucky, I was able to hitch a ride with Dubodlai, the milkman, who was delivering his wares to Munkacs by horse and wagon. Almost a picture of Tuvia, the milkmaker, Tuvia, the milkman, if you have probably no idea. Maybe you're wondering if we knew what was going on across the Hungarian borders, about the terrible shitas going on in Poland, Galicia and Kamenets-Podolsk especially. We didn't have any internet. We didn't have any television or even a telephone. And we didn't have any radio in our home. The question is, how did we get the news? The answer is, my friend, the mikveh. The mikveh was our center or news source. As a little boy of approximately 11, 12 years old, I really loved the mikveh, and I used to park myself in the corner and soak for hours and listen as Rav Feivel came in, and Rav Moshe and Rav Matas came in, and each one brought a different bulletin. Each one brought a different source of news, how the war is progressing and how the war is going. And I was able to absorb all that information and bring it home to my parents. It was Achron Shel Pesach, the day after Pesach in the morning. It was approximately early in the morning when there was a knock on our door. And my parents opened the door, and there were three officers standing there, two German officers and one Hungarian gendarme. And the following order was given to us. First of all, they wanted to ascertain how many members are in this family. Is anybody in hiding? Is anybody else who is in the house but not present? Once this was established, the order was given that we have 1 hour to pack whatever we can carry and report to the backyard of the local shul, which was approximately about 2 or 3 houses from us. My friends, I hope you never experience something like this, but somebody tells you, you have 1 hour to pack, and most likely you will never return to your home again. What do you take? What do you throw into this If you have any luggage, if you have suitcases. My mother didn't have any suitcases at that point, so she took an old bed sheet and spread it out and started throwing different articles of clothing in that sheet. And of course, there was still no hummus in the house, so there was no food to take along. But basically, whatever she thought she would throw into that bundle, she bundled it up, and sure enough, while this command was given, you give you 1 hour to pack, my two sisters, who were older than me, both of them were older than me, they heard that and they decided that they are going to run away. They are not going to report to the backyard of this particular shoe. We were bordering, our home was bordering, the back of our house was bordering a forested area with a lot of trees and shrubbery. My older sister went through the window first in the back, and then my younger sister, Dito and Yoli, and she suddenly turned, she had the presence of mind, and she turned to my younger sister, and she says, maybe you go back in and fetch some of our parents' valuables. Fetch my father's becher. Why don't you fetch the two candlesticks, the silver candlesticks that we were using? And also maybe some pieces of jewelry if you can, you know where they are. And why don't you bring it to me? And my younger sister obeyed and did this. And as she brought these items, she dug a hole in the ground right under that window where she went through. And she buried these articles in the ground. And then, of course, once we came into that backyard of the shul, as we were told, with my mother carrying that bundle, we didn't see my sister. She didn't see my sister. She was very, very upset. She was very distraught what happened to them. And I didn't know. Neither of us, my father didn't know, because they didn't tell us that they're trying to escape. But after about an hour and a half sitting in the backyard and counting us again and again that everybody who was supposed to be on the list is present, suddenly from a distance I see my sisters approaching, and I nudge my mother and I say, look here, girls are coming, they're not abandoning us. And as they joined us, they said with bitter cries, there's no place to hide. There's no place to go. There's no help we can expect from anybody. What is going to happen to you is going to happen to us. They marched us off to a temporary ghetto, which was approximately about 3-4 kilometers from that shul. It was in a brick factory. And there's a very good reason why they chose that particular brick factory for a temporary ghetto, because it also had access to railroad freight cars, and the freight cars moved them right into the midst of the brick factory. So eventually, when they had to load us up again and send us off, supposedly, to some Hungarian farms to do some farm work, which is what the Hungarian leadership made us to believe. So they wouldn't have too much trouble to bring us again over there. So eventually they loaded us up into those freight cars, about 80, 90 people to a empty freight car, which would be comfortable if you want to sit down or stand up, 50 or 55 people would be already too many. And suddenly the train started moving, and as, of course, they locked us up and the train started moving, suddenly they turned to me and say, Srulik, there's a little rectangular window in those freight cars. We will lift you up and I want you to look out, because when that train passed some a larger station, it slowed down. So why don't you read off for us the name of that particular station that the train is passing by? And sure, I did this. And pretty soon I could see on the faces of my parents and the faces of everybody present in that railroad freight car that we are not heading to some Hungarian farms for some labor, as we were told, but we were heading towards Poland. But it was, everybody was quiet. Silence spoke very loudly in that railroad car. Finally, the train slowed down, and everybody felt that this is not just going through a particular station again. Again, they lifted me up and they said, "Sulik, what do you see now?" And I say, "Oh, this is, I see the train is slowing down and I see a platform with tremendous amount of suitcases and other bundles on the platform." I think everybody knew that we finally arrived at our final destination, which was Auschwitz-Birkenau. As our freight train was slowly arriving in our final destination of Auschwitz-Birkenau, the command again was given, "Aussteigen." Disembark was over, reverberating in the air. My mother motioned to me to wait, not to disembark yet. Soon I realized that the only my parents and myself were still occupying that empty freight car. We were told that we must leave everything we were carrying behind on the platform adjacent to the train. My mother kept putting on additional clothing on me, thinking that whatever is on my person, I will be able to keep. My father, on the other hand, was standing in a corner of that empty freight car, and he was holding up my till, instructing me, "Sulik, hold on to them as long as possible." The young prisoner directing our arrival was not very pleased. I don't know, I never learned his name. He was approximately 20, 21 years old. He was in charge of these trains arriving to that platform. He was unhappy with us three still occupying that empty freight car. So what did he do? Suddenly he mounted the boxcar and cautioned my mother, saying, "Er wird das nicht dürfen." He will not be needing that. My mother was putting on this clothing on me, so I said, and he noticed that. And he said, "You will not be needing that. Why are you keep on doing that?" And then he looked directly at me, questioning, "Ingele, the oldest two. Boy, how old are you?" "Fersen," I said, "14. 14, I forgot. 9, he says. "Du bist nicht Fersen, du bist 18. You are not 14 and you are 18. "But if I'm 14, why are you telling me I'm 18? I was a little, you know, mischievous, fresh little boy." So I protested why he wanted to change my age. But my question was left unanswered. Instead, simply told me, "Now get off the train. This is the last time that I saw my mother. I never saw my mother again. I took that film from my father and put it in the shirt of my bosom, and we disembarked. We got off the freight car." Of course, in the process of selection which followed, to the question from the Malacham Obis, the German officer, "Why are you telling me I am 18? I protested, but my question was left unanswered. No. This was when I encountered that young man who gave me the tip that I am 18, I'm not 14. But during the process of election, my father was in front of me And I was behind my father. There was another person from my town also in front of my father. And I don't know whether it was Mengele or whether it was any other Malachamovas. I have never learned that. But the following question was given immediately. I heard to my father, the Augustus, that was the first question, how old are you? The second question was, kannst du arbeiten? Can you work? And he said, jawohl, and he pointed to go a certain direction. I followed, and I had all this clothing on me, and I stretched myself out. And he looks at me and he says, the Augustus. I could see immediately in front of my eyes this young man with a striped suit that I've never learned his name, I never saw him again. Du bist Achsen. And I suddenly shouted out, Achsen. And the following question was, kannst du arbeiten? Can you work? And I said, jawohl. A motion to me to follow in the same direction as my father. I followed my father in the direction they pointed us. And after many hours of marching, we finally reached a large barracks, like an airplane hangar, where we had to remove our clothing. The very last thing I placed on my pile of clothing when I was standing naked was my tefillin. Telling my father, I want you and Hashem should be moichel to me, but I cannot hold on to them anymore. We were issued a set of striped prisoner clothing, and after a few weeks of many daily appeals, assemblies to be counted over and over again, we were again headed and loaded up into freight cars and arrived in a concentration camp called Mauthausen. Mauthausen was the second concentration camp that I was brought to. There, in this camp, I was issued my prison number 66818. This little strip of number, that little piece of fabric, is still the original number that was handed to me with the words telling me, young boy, Wojciech, this is now your name, 68818. This is just the opposite of what young children do here. They, of course, when I believe that the shares of Plato and we started to turn into normal life, we assumed our names again, which was very, very important. But I can tell you that in the concentration camps itself, there was no such thing as a name, there was only a number. And if you committed some kind of a sin, and you were appointed for a oinish, for punishing, they called out the number. They did not call out Izzy Starkis or Srulik Star. So there was the difference that we had numbers as names, and now the children build names instead of numbers. We were issued a set of striped prisoner clothing, and after a few weeks, as I said, I reached Mauthausen, where I got this number. Unfortunately, this was also the place where I was accidentally separated from my father, never to see him again. Again, Mauthausen was a terrible, terrible camp. Mauthausen was a Vernichtungslager, basically, and also a supply camp where fresh prisoners were brought in from Auschwitz or from many other concentration camps and distributed as they needed for slave labor in all the satellite camps bordering around Mauthausen. I was assigned to another camp, the third camp, which was called Melk. Melk was in Austria. This is the third camp, where I was finally put to work and where the bulk of my prison days were spent. Our work detail was about 1 hour from our camp barracks. what was our work? We constructed an underground facility beneath a mountain consisting of multiple tunnels for the purpose of manufacturing war material for the German industry. You see, planes that were on bombing missions couldn't see what was going on under that mountain. My assignment in Melk was to be a Spitzenträger, a carrier of the pointers. My job was to carry, to pick up from the prisoners in the tunnels the dull pointers that they were working with heading into the mountain. Fortunately, that mountain was not of stone or coal, it was a mountain of sand and gravel. So, but nevertheless, they all worked with these air hammers, and these pointers, steel pointers, sometimes got dull and they had to sharpen. But there was no way that you could have a fire going inside the tunnel itself because it would consume a lot of the oxygen of these tunnels. So basically, my job was to carry out these dull pointers to the blacksmith who was outside, and he would sharpen them. My friends, can you imagine the tremendous advantage that I enjoyed having access to fire? As a little boy, I learned that dysentery, of course, was a machla, was a terrible sickness, and especially in the camps, it was just like, broke out like a wildfire, and many, many prisoners, unfortunately, came down with this. And I, as a young boy, remember that charcoal dust was a big remedy for this particular type of a problem. So I went to the blacksmith and I told him, listen, I'm going to take a block of wood and can I put it in the fire? And I will burn it till it's real glowing coal. And then I cooled it off and it got black, and I scraped off that coal dust, that dust from that piece of burned wood. But unfortunately, I had no place to package it. I wanted to distribute it to my friends that are suffering from that particular ailment. Finally, the blacksmith told me there is some pond next, not far away, and there's some big leaves growing there. So I took those leaves and I packaged this coal dust in those leaves and distributed to some of my friends that came down with the dysentery. Many people that suffered dysentery to the point where they got so weak they couldn't work anymore, had to go into the revere, had to go into the hospital. I don't know of anybody that checked in that ever checked out from this hospital. We also want to tell you that we did not have any paper calendars. We did not have any pencils, we did not have any watches, but we did have Koppel, the keeper of the calendar. Why was Koppel so important? Because, let's face it, we didn't need to know whether it was Monday or Friday, or whether it was Schwedish or Shavuot or Thomas, or whether a holiday was approaching or not approaching, what was the difference? But nevertheless, there were people still wanted to know something like this. And since we didn't have any calendars, we didn't have anything else except we knew when was daylight, when was nighttime, Koppel always was right. Koppel knew, he had a computer up here. He always knew what holidays approaching, and he told us and gave us assurance. One day we returned from work, and I see there's a lot of whispering going on. And I say to my friends, I turn to my friends and I say, what is going on that everybody is so busy with? And he says, well, we finally found out that tonight is Yom Kippur night. So I said, well, what's the difference? Tonight is going to be the same night as any other night. They're going to put out the lights, at a particular time, and we are all going to go sleep in the bunk. I always managed to get to sleep on the top of the three-tier bunk, and sometimes we were seven, eight, or nine people facing, one facing this way, like the sardines, one facing the other way. And since we learned that it is in Kippur night, everybody transported, I would say psychologically, back. And I pictured myself standing next to my father in Yom Kippur night, because my father was a shliach tzibur. He was representing about Philip, and I helped him out, and suddenly the terrible, terrible cries from every corner of the barracks could be heard. And as these cries went on, suddenly a voice came, "Kol Nidrei." Somebody got up and started saying "Kol Nidrei." And as he finished, somebody else got up and started saying, "Hine Kachoimer," and so forth, the next kapitel. And as I was laying on my bunk and crying with bitter tears, remembering what Yom Kippur was like at home, I fell asleep. In the morning, I wake up in the morning, the usual time, when we have to get ready to go to work. And I turned to my friends, and I said, "I had a wonderful dream. I dreamt that it is Yom Kippur night, and we are saying a lot of the tefillahs, we are saying Kol Nidrei." And they said, "What do you mean you dreamt?" I said, "Yes, I dreamt. I mean," they said, "that was no dream. That was reality. This is what he, you fell asleep in the middle of this probably, and you think that this whole thing was a dream, but it was not a dream." And I turned to them and I said, "And Fritz, our Rockelster, or our couple, did not report this to the SS, and he says, "Nothing happened. We survived." And we did survive. Also, I would like to tell you about another Mesiras Nefesh. One hot summer day, as I emerged from the mouth of the cool tunnel with my dull drill bits, Weber, who was a neighbor of ours, who was working at the very end of this, there was a conveyor belt moving in and out of those tunnels, carrying the debris that the prisoners were drilling at, or some other prisoners were shoveling that debris on that conveyor belt, and the conveyor belt was transporting all that debris out of the tunnels. And Weber worked at the very end of that conveyor belt, where anything fell off from the conveyor belt, he had to shovel back onto a little car, a little steel car. Suddenly, Weber approaches me and says, "Sulek, come with me." And I says, "Weber, where are we going?" And I'm schlepping those dull steel pointers with me. It was a very, very hot day, I remember that. And he says, "Just come with me, but we cannot walk upright because the guards will see that we are heading to a place where we shouldn't be. So we have to crawl. So why don't you crawl after me?" So we started crawling, and I said, "Weber, you must have found some real food. You must have found something to eat. That's where we are taking me. Aren't you doing this?" He says, "We'll be there very soon." And sure enough, he's pointed to a broken down, one of those steel cars, broken down, and he says, "We are going to go through the back opening to this car." And I follow him, and I'm thinking, he's going to share with me some real tremendous, tremendous find of food that he found. Otherwise, why would he schlep me there? Suddenly, I come in, and I'm very hot, and I'm wiping off my sweat, and I'm looking up, and I see a whole bunch of twigs and branches on top of that broken down steel car. And I look up, and it was nice and cool because of the shade, and I say, "Weber, is this a sukkah?" He says, "Sulek, is This is ours, yours and mine. I says, Weber, what, do you have something? Do you have something to eat? I remember Sukkot, that we had all these wonderful cakes and herring and schnapps and wine. We have nothing. He says, I'm sorry, Sulik, I cannot have, I don't have anything, but I have one thing I can offer you. We will both sit down and make a brucha layeshei basuka. And we all both sat down and we started crying. And I said, you schlepped me all here, but maybe it is something that is going to be a schus for us that you went through and you mesiras nefesh and you built that sukkah and we made a brucha of layeshei basuka. We left and I schlepped and I crawled back out, back to the blacksmith. And again, one day, again, someone suddenly was whispering that there are people among us for a great secret revelation that my friend, Mr. Estreicher, was also a mukacher, while unloading 50 kilo cement bags, found tattered and torn shalyat. This was dangerous information. If the person smuggling into camp would be discovered with this torn shalyat, as time rolled on and we continued without any new knowledge of the war's progressing status, many times I was faced with the multiple questions from older advisor inmates and friends. Shrulik, why are you encouraging us to hold out another month, another week, or another day? Just turn around and see the pile of corpses behind you. We will all end up there, sooner or later. We will all, the only way we'll go out here is through the smoke that is going through this chimney there. So why suffer? I was not able to give much of a counter argument, except that I am not a Navi. I am not a prophet of God. I only know that there is a war flaming, and maybe, just maybe, we will survive. But giving up hope, or giving up all hope, is certain death. Sure enough, as the Russian army was approaching Vienna and Melk, we were marched to Ebensee in Austria, near Linz. This is the fourth and final camp. We must have arrived here about the middle of March 1945, just a small remnant of the hundreds that started up on the trip. In Ebensee, we were not assigned to any type of work detail, but we were also not given the daily portion of the so-called bread. Suddenly, one morning, which must have been on May 6th or 7th, I noticed that the guard towers surrounding the camp were no longer occupied by SS Army personnel with machine guns. Maybe. Just maybe liberation was at hand, I said to my friends. Soon, the sounds of artillery confirmed this, and I elected to stand with my friends at the gates to welcome our liberators. My dear friends, the saga or the story of liberation is in itself a most important episode. I could speak for a few hours just about the period when we were standing liberated. Food, food, give us food, was the unanimous call of the prisoners. Sure enough, the American liberators brought in an army field kitchen and dished out a concoction of rice with fat bacon. I can assure you that that moment and my friends would have gladly given our lives in exchange for just a loaf of bread, or even a half a loaf of bread. So why did I urge my friends not to join the line to partake in this dish out? Something about just the smell of it made me nauseous. And subsequently, we saw as people began gobbling up this concoction of fat bacon and rice, suddenly they were collapsing and falling down, and they died because their digestive system was so shrunk that this concussion of fat, bacon, and rice just exploded in their innards and they couldn't take it. And many of them, unfortunately, died at this moment. While this was going on in the distance, I noticed the second long line had formed mostly of my surviving friends. And I urged them, my friends, let's go and see, let's approach this line and see what they're giving away over there. And as we approached, I noticed the Chustara of Rav Sheila Greenwald holding a tattered and torn shalyat. As my turn came to approach and to make a bracha, Ol Huniyach al Mitzvah's Tilum, I cried out to Ribbono Shel Olam. This was the last thing I gave up standing naked. And now at the moment of liberation, this is the first mitzvah I performed. My friends, my father was a very wise man. He had known that under the circumstances, I would not be able to hold on to my tefillin very much longer. So what did he mean by telling me to do so? Hold on to them, Zulim. The Gemara states, V'yiru ki shem Hashem nikru aleichu v'yiru memenu. And they will notice that the name of Hashem, which is the tefillin that the bear appears on your head, they will be fearful of you. This is what the Gemara says. Chazal explained, Eilu tefillin shebarosh. They don't explain that these are the tefillin that we wear on top of our heads. No, these are the tefillin that we are wear in our brains. Meaning that the tefillin should have a hashpua influence on the mind of the wearer. If we wear them with Kedusha and Tahara, we would then internalize the lessons of our Torah given over to us by our forefathers and our teachers. Just as it says, Sha'allah v'ichu v'yagetchu, zekeinechu v'yamukloch. Ask your father, and he will tell you, and your elders, and they will relate to you. What a few words. What my father was urging me to hold on to, my friends, was the Kedusha and Tahara that my parents and my teachers had installed in me. There is a Gemara in Sanhedrin 92, Atzomas Yivashas Shehechi Yecheskel Ma'akorlehem. The dry bones that Heskel brought back to life, whatever happened to these dry bones? Though all agreed that the resurrected bones was a nesman, a miracle in Hashemayim, there is a difference of opinion between Rabbi Lozer and Rabbi Lezer. Rabbi Lozer says that the bones that came to life recited Shira again and they died. The songs of praise to Hashem and they died again. In contrast, Rabbi Lezer says, no. Olu le'eretz Yisroel nosu noshim bo'elidu bunim abunois. These dry bones went up to Eretz Yisroel. And they married there. And they started having families and new generations. And they lived on. And to underscore the third draft, Rabbi Lezer ben Yisera later, he says, Ani Mendei Benayim, he says, I am a descendant of these dry bones. And what's his proof that he's a descendant? Tfilon Sherniach Li Abba. The tfilon that my father left me, they can be traced to these dry bones. My friends, I too am a remnant of the Tzomus Yivashas. I'm also a remnant of the dry bones that received a second chance. I could have used a bowl of rice to fill my empty and aching stomach. So why was I standing in line to don a torn and tattered shalyat? Because the tefillin Sherniach Li Abba, the tefillin that my father left me, because of the spiritual tefillin that my father left me, Barosh. The fact that we have today Beis Yaakov's, Talmud Torahs, and day schools overflowing with Yankelech and Ruchelech, and Mekoymo Shel Torah, all over the world is because of the tefillin Shehoniach Lechem Abba. Because of the values and principles based on generations of Messiah that was given to me and to you by your forefathers. And then, at the war end, given to the Sheiris later by Shlichim like Rabbi Yekusiel Halberstam, Zechron Lebrocha, the Rosenburger Rebbe, the Chuster Rebbe, Rabbi Eliezer Brody from Cincinnati, and many other Shlichim from Eretz Yisroel that came to give us chizuk, to give us some strength. At liberation, even after the darkest moments, when many proclaimed, Cholila, less din, but less dying, there is no God, Cholila. There is no din, and there is no dying. There is no law, and there is no judge. And decided for themselves, I will be a good person. I will not steal. I will not murder. But I am no longer an observant Jew. It was then that the Gedolim spoke, these Gedolim that I mentioned spoke with one voice, saying, Yidden, Acheinu Beis Yisroel, we have no other choice except to reconfirm Torah's Avoseinu. And they did in the time, as they did in the time of Purim, Kimu v'kiblu mashe kiblu kvar. They reinforced and re-accepted something which they have accepted long time ago at Har Sinai. Otherwise, if we will not do this, if we will not accept Torah Sheba Ksav and Torah Sheba Peh, otherwise, if we will not accept it as during Zeman Matan Tarusenu, Shom Tie Kevoraskan, there would be your burial place. Where? In Auschwitz, Treblinka, and Sobibor. There would not have been any future generations left to remember the tragedy of Khurban Europe and to carry on the Masorah for which so many demonstrated. Yehi Zichron Baruch. Thank you.
Her father died 1 year later from dysentery, and Sarah was left an orphan. Her uncle and great uncle took her into their home, and Sarah stayed with her aunt when they left for the war in Russia. In 1945, Sarah, then age 7, returned to Poland with her uncles. While spending 2.5 years in a DP camp, Sarah was in touch with a great uncle who lived with his wife and children in Brooklyn. Sarah traveled by herself to the United States, where she lived with her great uncle's family until she was 18. Sarah married her husband when she was 19. She worked as a stenographer and a teacher in a nursery school. She also went back to Queens College in 1973 and received a BA and master's and began working as a dean of students at Queens at the age of 47. Sarah received the CUNY Student Personnel Award in 2000 for her incredible work in Queens College. She has 3 children, 5 grandchildren, and 2 great-grandchildren. Herman Pepper was born in Bialystok, July 1925. Herman was one of 6 children. His father had died before the war. His mother and sisters were killed by the Germans in their town. His brothers were taken to Auschwitz and were killed. Mr. Tepper was 14 when the war broke out and worked in several labor camps, including Schlossberg, where Herman was one of the few people who survived of 1,200 prisoners. Mr. Tepper was in Mauthausen toward the end of the war. He recalls a tall man dressed in white who handed him a small bag of sugar. He ran to thank the man, but never saw him again. In one of the camps, Herman was being led by SS guards to be hanged. As they were walking him down several flights of stairs, Herman escaped and hid in a bathroom for days, trembling with fear, but determined to survive. When he arrived in America, Herman worked as a tailor for 1.5 years, and then married and was a hard-working cab driver until his retirement. He has 3 children, 9 grandchildren, and 10 great-grandchildren. Sesha Tau was born in Vitka, Poland, and was 12 years old when the war broke out. She was one of 8 children in an Orthodox home. Her father was a Ger Chassid. In 1940, her family was moved into a ghetto. In 1942, at 4 a.m., German soldiers kicked open their door and took everyone to Sosnowitz, which was a 1-hour walk. They stayed in a huge building with Jews from all over, with no food or water. Her family was separated, Sesha being left with 1 sister. She never saw anyone else from her family again. That evening, the Nazis took 45 girls on a train to a camp in Czechoslovakia where she worked for 3 years. There was a kind director who visited the camp twice a week, who they later found out was an English spy. After the war, Sesha returned to her home to search for survivors. Her house was occupied by a Polish woman who told her to run and leave, and she did. She returned to Germany by train and foot, where she lived with her sister in a 1-room apartment. Sesha and her sister eventually traveled to Chemyshitz, where they found 2 uncles and many family members. One of her uncles had a beer factory, which had been protected by a trustworthy Polish neighbor. Sesha and her sister stayed in this packed house with her uncle, who was the president of the Hebrew Immigration Aid Society and helped all of his family members obtain passports and visas. Sesha met her husband in a DP camp in Germany, where he was the head bookkeeper and she was his secretary. He traveled to America with his family, and Sesha arrived a year later in 1950. Sesha and her husband had 2 children, 3 grandchildren, and 5 great-grandchildren. Helena Bomstein was born Faye Sarowis Nikki in Warsaw, Poland. Before Helena was born, her parents had taken in 3 orphan cousins who were like siblings to Helena. She attended a religious elementary school and went to a Polish high school. She recalls an idyllic child with family get-togethers and birthday celebrations until the war broke out before Helena's 18th birthday. Her family was moved to the Warsaw Ghetto and received scant rations. By the time she was 19 years old, every single member of her family had either disappeared from a work detail or had been formally deported. One morning, a Polish man arrived at the ghetto wanting to see Helena's father. He insisted that her father had saved his life during the Great War and he wanted to help him escape the ghetto. Upon learning that her father was gone, the Pole returned with false papers for Helena and helped her escape from the ghetto. Helena, however, decided to return to the ghetto because she preferred to live as a Jew. Helena was ultimately deported to Majdanek and then Auschwitz, where she was assigned to slave labor. There, unbearable conditions became her life. At the end of 1944, Helena was taken to Ravensbrück, where she worked in a German aviation factory. When Red Cross officials took them to Sweden in April 1945, a group of Nazis attacked their group as they traveled through Denmark. Helena arrived in Sweden on the last day of Pesach in 1945 at 23 years old. While living with 15 women survivors in Sweden, Helena began corresponding with a young man who was recovering from the camps in a convalescent home. When he was released, he arrived at Helena's doorstep and proposed marriage. Around the same time, Helena learned that one of her brothers had survived. Helena and her husband Chaim began their life together in Sweden, but ultimately came to the United States. They raised three daughters together and remained close to Helena's brother and his wife until they passed away. Helena is grateful for the nachas her daughters, sons-in-law, and their children have brought to her life. Bertha Wagner was born in Antwerp, Belgium on April 24, 1931, the baby of six children. She enjoyed a beautiful early family life with freedom and education. There was school on Shabbos, but her parents didn't allow her and her siblings to attend. By 1942, restrictions against Jews were implemented. Bertha's father was imprisoned and sent away. Roundups began, and Bertha's three brothers, ages 20, 18, and 16, were all deported and never returned. A cousin of theirs suggested that Bertha's mother and her daughter should relocate to the French side of Belgium, where there was a smaller population of Jewish people. A righteous Gentile doctor who was helping the family took Bertha and her sister to a convent. Bertha's mother was hiding in a Catholic hospital. When they learned from the underground that it was known that Jewish children were being hidden in that convent, Bertha and her sister were moved to another convent. After the war, the doctor told Bertha's mother where her daughters were hidden, and she was able to be reunited with them. Her mother was 42 years old and had lost a husband and four children. Bertha, her mother, and her sister stayed in Belgium until 1957, when Bertha came alone to the United States. Bertha credits her mother for continuing to give her and her sister endless love and support despite the difficult circumstances. Bertha and her husband married and had two children. She has 10 grandchildren and 2 great-grandchildren. You all may know that Fania Gottesfeld Heller was a Holocaust survivor who was passionate about educating the world about the Shoah. Mrs. Heller was a longtime sponsor of the keynote speaker portion of this program. Sadly, Mrs. Heller passed away a few months ago. And tonight, we invite her family to light a candle in her memory. Fania was born in Skala, a Ukrainian village in 1924, and was a teenager when the war broke out. She was an excellent student and dreamed of becoming a doctor. A local Ukrainian police officer hid Fania and her family in his mother's attic. She was then later hidden with her family in the barn of a Polish peasant. Four people, hidden in a space large enough for two, required the family to remain in a crouching position for nearly 2.5 years with no air, no light, or water. Years later, Fania was reunited with the daughter of the Polish man who had hidden her family, and she kept in touch with her for the rest of her life. Fania wrote her memoirs, Love in a World of Sorrow, a teenage girl's Holocaust memoirs, which served as the basis for her film, Teenage Witness, the Fania Heller story, released in 2010. Fania wrote a second book based on her memoirs designed for 5th to 8th graders, which was met with extraordinary success within days of being released by Scholastic. She spoke about her own experiences in many different forums and was recognized by several institutions, including the Museum of Jewish Heritage and the New York State Board of Regents for her contributions to Holocaust education. Fania had immense joy from her 3 children, 8 grandchildren, and over 20 great-grandchildren. Now ask Chazan Charles Mulbauer to lead us in the Kel Mole, followed by Anya Mamman.
Mole Rachamim. zichron mavon shemeshanachnu mispananim bialazukam bialazukodas nishmon zeyhem meganeiten zeyhem uchosom lochim borachamim yas tilem seser knofo Leolim, Yitzror mitzvah l'chaim, es nishmoseyem. Adonai, unachalosom, v'yanchu l'shalom, amishkevoseyem.
Either disappeared from a work detail or had been formally deported. One morning, a Polish man arrived at the ghetto wanting to see Helena's father. He insisted that her father had saved his life during the Great War and he wanted to help him escape the ghetto. Upon learning that her father was gone, the Pole returned with false papers for Helena and helped her escape from the ghetto. Helena, however, decided to return to the ghetto because she preferred to live as a Jew. Helena was ultimately deported to Majdanek and then Auschwitz, where she was assigned to slave labor. There, unbearable conditions became her life. At the end of 1944, Helena was taken to Ravensbrück, where she worked in a German aviation factory. When Red Cross officials took them to Sweden in April 1945, a group of Nazis attacked their group as they traveled through Denmark. Helena arrived in Sweden on the last day of Pesach in 1945 at 23 years old. While living with 15 women survivors in Sweden, Helena began corresponding with a young man who was recovering from the camps in a convalescent home. When he was released, he arrived at Helena's doorstep and proposed marriage. Around the same time, Helena learned that one of her brothers had survived. Helena and her husband Chaim began their life together in Sweden, but ultimately came to the United States. They raised three daughters together and remained close to Helena's brother and his wife until they passed away. Helena is grateful for the nachas her daughters, sons-in-law, and their children have brought to her life. Bertha Wagner was born in Antwerp, Belgium on April 24, 1931, the baby of six children. She enjoyed a beautiful early family life of freedom and education. There was school on Shabbos, but her parents didn't allow her and her siblings to attend. By 1942, restrictions against Jews were implemented. Bertha's father was imprisoned and sent away. Roundups began, and Bertha's three brothers, ages 20, 18, and 16, were all deported and never returned. A cousin of theirs suggested that Bertha's mother and her daughter should relocate to the French side of Belgium, where there was a smaller population of Jewish people. A righteous Gentile doctor who was helping the family took Bertha and her sister to a convent. Bertha's mother was hiding in a Catholic hospital. When they learned from the underground that it was known that Jewish children were being hidden in that convent, Bertha and her sister were moved to another convent. After the war, the doctor told Bertha's mother where her daughters were hidden, and she was able to be reunited with them. Her mother was 42 years old and had lost a husband and four children. Bertha, her mother, and her sister stayed in Belgium until 1957 when Bertha came alone to the United States. Bertha credits her mother for continuing to give her and her sister endless love and support despite the difficult circumstances. Bertha and her husband married and had two children. She has 10 grandchildren and 2 great-grandchildren. You only know that Fania Gottesfeld Heller was a Holocaust survivor who was passionate about educating the world about the Shoah. Mrs. Heller was a longtime sponsor of the keynote speaker portion of this program. Sadly, Mrs. Heller passed away a few months ago, and tonight we invite her family to light a candle in her memory. Fania was born in Skala, a Ukrainian village in 1924, and was a teenager when the war broke out. She was an excellent student and dreamed of becoming a doctor. A local Ukrainian police officer hid Fania and her family in his mother's attic. She was then later hidden with her family in the barn of a Polish peasant. Four people, hidden in a space large enough for two, required the family to remain in a crouching position for nearly 2.5 years with no air, no light, or water. Years later, Fania was reunited with the daughter of the Polish man who had hidden her family, and she kept in touch with her for the rest of her life. Fania wrote her memoirs, Love in a World of Sorrow, a teenage girl's Holocaust memoirs, which served as the basis for her film, Teenage Witness, The Fania Heller Story, released in 2010. Fania wrote a second book based on her memoirs designed for 5th to 8th graders, which was met with extraordinary success within days of being released by Scholastic. She spoke about her own experiences in many different forums and was recognized by several institutions, including the Museum of Jewish Heritage and the New York State Board of Regents for her contributions to Holocaust education. Fania had immense joy from her 3 children, 8 grandchildren, and over 20 great-grandchildren. Now ask Chazen Charles Mulbauer to lead us in the Kail Mele, followed by Anya Mamman.
Oh, my God.